Whether you need some fun PCBs for the holidays or something more serious, head over to the PCBWay website and click on the PCB instant quote. Then you can select various types of PCBs and your PCB specifications. You can then select if you want the stencil mask and even the assembly service. Then click calculate and simply place your order. Hello YouTubers and welcome to this T4D, where I'm going to tell you how I managed to blow both of my GPS disciplined oscillators. So there is going to be a bit of preamble before I get into the actual explanation of how I managed to blow these. I'll place a time code over here if you don't want to go through the preamble or chit chat beforehand, giving a bit of background and the kind of status on the things I've been playing with. So before we get into that, I just want to wish you all a happy new year. I hope you've had a nice rest over the festive period. I kind of have had a little break, fortunately, to spend time with the family and to kind of play without filming, which is also nice as well. It gave me time to dig out a couple of projects. The one being the college power supply. So I have that on the bench. I'm going to give you an update on that. And then also my DIY clock, which is part of the reason why these GPS disciplined oscillators came up. I've been playing with that to inject a signal so that I can make it a really precise clock. I'm aiming for sub 5 seconds or even sub 3 seconds accuracy per year standalone. So with no external time source correcting it, either a GPS signal or a radio wave or the internet, just its own time base to keep that accuracy. And I'll talk more about that to say when we get to the bench. And there'll be a few videos covering that because this has been quite a challenging project to get to this point. But anyway, the college power supply. So let me just tell you a bit about that. I've pulled that out. As you may realize, I've obviously not touched that project for a long time. The last one, I think we were looking at the stability or op-amp feedback and the stability of the op-amp. There were some issues there. I did a theoretical video on that. And the next video I wanted to do was basically going to practice and show how we could correct that. Now, I'd taken the components from a breadboard onto a little strip board, and I had the issue there. But what I want to do is basically go off and create a prototype PC board, PCB, and put the components in there correctly with the correct lead lengths and all that kind of thing, just to do a comparison to see what happens. We're still going to talk about and try and correct that feedback error. So that's been my challenge. I've dug it all out. I've got the circuit diagram on my PC. I'm using RS components. What's it? Spark Design or Design Spark. I'll put the title up here. I've forgotten it. But with that, you can get a PCB layout and do auto routing. And I haven't done this for years. Basically, when I was in college studying electronics back in the 90s, that's when I did it last. I'm playing around with this and the software is already throwing up errors because of some issue, perhaps with the way it's trying to read the component, the circuit diagram that I've got. I'm trying to upgrade to a later version to make sure there's no improvements on the auto routing. So that's my challenge. I will take you down that avenue as well, because I think for those of you who haven't designed your own PCBs or used a CAD program to do that and auto routing, that'll be quite an education. And then once I've done it with this software, I know, for instance, Chris Gamble would probably be shouting knowing what I'm using, but I'll then jump in and try some other software so that we can see how well that works. Right, so that's the college power supply. That is starting to happen again. Then I tell you what, I'm going to take you down onto the bench and show you this quickly, this clock project, just to give you an overview, because there are going to be some interesting videos coming on that. And as again, the reason these videos are happening instead of, let's say, the review on that bench multimeter, these I put aside ages ago when I was busy working inside my small cabin outside. I had to show off those while I was building this. So I just want to revisit those, get them done. It's something I'm intrigued with. And then we'll jump back and do some of those reviews. Okay, so excuse a bit of freehand. There's a lot to show you, which I cannot get in view once I've got the camera mounted. So I'll just quickly show you, this is the college power supply. I've got it up here. Down on the floor, you'll see I've got the lid and the breadboard with the original circuit that we were playing with. And this is where I took it to the strip board and where we started having issues potentially with feedback with the op amp. So I've got all that out in the circuit diagrams. We're going to talk about these, and maybe there's a little hint staring you in the face as to how I blew both of these. The clock has been an interesting project in terms of understanding measurements and how you can, when you attach measurement devices, how you can mess up the workings of a circuit, trying to find the right test equipment to do the measurements, getting the settings right on test equipment, testing new test equipment, because like my one frequency counter that I had couldn't do what I want. So let me just quickly mount the camera before I even do that. The one thing is, fair enough, I needed a frequency counter, but sometimes buying frequency counters is expensive. So what I went and looked at was trying to find a cheaper option. And if you've been hunting around on eBay, you may recognize this unit. I am busy testing it, and I will say that I am reasonably impressed by what it can do. As long as it's not without its faults, if you increase the gate time and perhaps input a reference signal, the internal oscillator is not too bad, but I've got some longer term testing to do with both this device and this little signal generator over here. Okay, so this might be a bit of a challenge. I'm trying to get everything in view just to give you a quick overview of this project. So as I mentioned, as you realize that I've got a load of quartz wristwatches, which I've been studying for over close to 2 years now in terms of their design and their accuracy. I enjoy timekeeping. One of my frustrations is that you cannot buy a clock, an accurate clock. Any quartz wristwatch, unless you start getting into the high accuracy quartz wristwatches, start costing a lot of money. But if you try and search for a high accuracy clock which doesn't have a GPS signal or a radio wave input or an update from the internet using the NTP time protocol, you cannot find them unless you're going to try and buy yourself an atomic clock. So what I wanted to see was whether I could take a cheap clock circuit, and these circuits, you build them yourself, they cost less than $10. Sometimes you can get them for as low as $3. Remove the crystal. Now, the one interesting point on here, this has got a 12 megahertz crystal as opposed to the standard 32768 hertz crystal, which is used for most clocks and wristwatches. So having a 12 megahertz crystal has some certain advantages. When you start getting into high frequency oscillators, you potentially get better quality. You can get temperature compensated and ovenized crystals far easier than you can general clock crystals. So I'm injecting the signal, and the challenge has been to inject the right signal and get it set precisely. At 12 megahertz, this runs at like, I think it was like plus 42 seconds per day. It was way out. So you can never use it as a clock as it comes with its very cheap 12 megahertz crystal. So I'm using the signal generator, and I can tell you now I thank my lucky stars that I've got a GPS disciplined oscillator, because to do the measurements that I'm doing, I need a precise signal going into my signal generator and the counter. Because if both of those were using the internal oscillators, the error there wouldn't allow me to do the precise measurements that I'm doing. But basically what I've been able to do, and here comes a recommendation. I've only learnt probably now into my third or fourth frequency counter. This Hewlett-Packard or Agilent or Keysight, the 53131A, there's a 53132A and then a 53181, oh I forget, but an RF version of this. These are discontinued, but there's plenty of them on eBay. And If you're going to only buy one frequency counter, buy one of these. You need to do some clever hunting around on eBay, but once you do, they really are nice counters. What this is allowing me to do, my challenge is measuring the 1 second pulse to understand whether I'm getting a very precise 1 second pulse. I need to measure, I've got these flashing LEDs. And again, this is what I'll go to when I start doing the video series on this. So I'm having to measure that signal, which has a number of challenges in itself in terms of jitter and noise. I'm having to measure that. And then when you're measuring something that long in terms of time, it's a challenge to measure for a second and measure down to, let's say, nanoseconds or picoseconds. So averaging over a long time helps you do that. And that is what I'm doing on the frequency counter here. And I'm getting very good results by being able to do that. I can then adjust the frequency, and I do it like once or twice a day. And then I check that I'm maintaining good time. And if you have a look, forget the hours and the minutes. I'm just playing around with the seconds. You can see with atomic time at the moment, they are to the eye precisely in sync. Now, if you leave this for a day or so and you see them going out, well, then you've got an issue. You need to make more adjustments. But that's where I am at the moment. I've managed to now, over a day, still have them precise. And I think I've almost got the precise frequency that it's working at. And from there, obviously, I can't have it tied to a function generator, which is getting a GPS signal. I've got several 12 megahertz oscillator options. Some are temperature compensated and some are ovenized. And then I'm going to see whether I can use one of those and get a really accurate clock out of it. Right then, so let's get down to the main talking point. And that's how I managed to blow both of these GPS disciplined oscillators. And then I've got a really strong recommendation to make, and that is going to be this device here. So we'll talk about this because I haven't done a proper review of this, and I certainly do want to talk about it. I've been very pleased with it. Now, what I want you to do, if you're staring down at this on my bench right now, seeing all these components, I want you to pause the video if you know straight off how I've managed to go and blow both of these. Because I certainly, when I saw both of them not working, I kind of thought, I think I know what I've done wrong. But when I went digging around on the internet, it took me a long time to really unearth and confirm what I thought. And certainly to those of you who are RF or radio people, you may straight away go, I know exactly what you've done. But pause and post your comment, say, before I get into this, and let's see if you can guess what I did wrong. Right. So let me explain. So when I was in my little cabin, I obviously purchased my main big disciplined oscillator. The reason I bought it was not to as a reference for my bench equipment. I just wanted an accurate time source which didn't rely on the radio wave time signal, because sometimes you don't receive that. Whereas you always potentially, as long as you've got an antenna in the right place, you can always get a GPS signal and be assured then that the time you're getting is correct. And that's why I bought that, to check the time of my wristwatches. Crazy as it sounds, but I've soon realized the value in having it for my bench equipment. So I bought some more. This one was on recommendation from one of you who watched that video and said, hey, you should go and check these guys out. And I'm really chuffed that person did post that. And I bought these just to see what you could get at a more reasonable price, and to have another reference to even check against the main big boy I had on the bench. I bought this one off eBay. You can buy these GPS disciplined oscillators for around $80-$90. You can get ones with displays on them, which go for around $150 to $200. So they'll come with a, once you've got the antenna in there, you can get, I think, the GPS data out through this RS-232. It runs off a DC supply in the back, and then you get your 10 megahertz reference out in the front, and your one pulse per second out, a nice accurate one pulse per second. So that's that device. And then I was pointed to this one, and this is from Leo Bodnar. It's an English UK company. And the beauty about this one, for one, the size, really nice packaging. It's, you can power it with a USB. I say you can. This one you only power with a USB. But it also gives you the flexibility of programming it to output either 400 hertz to 810 megahertz, which means you don't necessarily need to have to use it as a reference input to your bench test equipment. I'm going to talk about how I'm going to use this now. You can set it to what frequency you like in that range. It is very stable and accurate, and that means you can use it for a whole host of projects. And that's what I'm still going to end up doing. Right, so how did I blow these? In my cabin, at my small little cabin, I had three antennas, I think. I had one main antenna for my main disciplined oscillator, and then I had two of these puck GPS antennas, one for each of these devices. And what happened when I moved in here, outside in one of the videos I would have shown you, I put up the GPS antennas, I drilled a hole through the wall, I pulled the cables through, I've got the three antennas there, but one of the cables wasn't long enough to make it in through the wall. One I had to extend, the puck antenna, I had to extend one of them to get it in. So I thought, okay, bit of a niggle, let me just get a splitter and take the antenna signal and split it into both of these. And that was my mistake. So why was that a mistake? Basically, these puck antennas are active. They run off, you can see this one runs off anywhere between 3 to 5 volts. You can have a broader voltage range. That voltage is supplied by your GPS inside. So the GPS will have an output, it'll output the power to supply this, and then you'll get the weak GPS signal coming back, right? So that's fine. If you have one of these to one of these, you're going to supply it with the voltage, there's a load, you then get the signal coming back. But now if you go and hook up two of these together in parallel to one of these antennas, what you end up doing then is you then pushing, you've got one of them feeding the load, but you potentially have another one. You only need a small voltage difference. Potentially these could run at one could run at 3 volts, one at 5 volts. Even if they were both 5 volts, and in theory you think they might balance and not push the power back into the other one, you only need a few millivolt difference, and you're then pushing power back into either one of them. And that, I'm 95% sure that's what happened. I've blown the GPS inputs to both of these by doing that. So we live and learn. How do you get around that, right? Because no, even when I was searching for this, there's nothing that really says, oh, don't go and split the signal from one of these puck antennas with a simple splitter like this. I had to really dig to find someone eventually hinting towards this fact that that might be an issue. So how do you get around this? You can go and buy a GPS signal splitter. And I'll insert in the screen here without the price. I'm going to show you just one by two. So basically one signal in, split to two, which would do the job here. So what these devices do, which of course you don't get when you just have a simple silly pigtail like I used, is they will do DC blocking on one of these. So one of the inputs, there are a few variances, one of the inputs will allow the DC signal in to go and feed your puck antenna, and then the other one will have a DC block. It won't allow the DC signal in, and it will also potentially have a 200 ohm load, because that GPS electronics might need to see a load so it doesn't have an error. So it'll have like a dummy load, if you will. It'll have a load there, and it blocks the DC from going up into the antenna. And that is what will save this. However, now let me show you the price point. So I'm going to reinsert and show you the price point of just this one by two, $300. Bearing in mind that one of these you can buy for like $10, $15, $20 is the price range that you can buy one of these puck antennas for. So you can, and then when you start stepping up to, let's say, a 1x4 or a 1x6 or 1x8, it goes crazy. $600, $900 is what you end up paying for these splitters. I have seen some electronics guys developing ones, DIY kits, to get them cheaper, maybe around $100 or $150. But when you first go searching, you're potentially going to find ones which are expensive. So unless you're in a situation where you can only feed in one cable and you've got issues with trying to feed in more cables or wire, it's difficult to place another antenna. It just makes sense to go and buy multiple antennas. And there are more reasons for that. You may have differences in the signal that you need. So buy the required puck and GPS antenna for each of your devices, unless there's a real need to go and get one of those splitters. I say, hopefully, lesson learned for other folks. Don't do as I did, because then you end up blowing them. So have I totally lucked out then in terms of these devices, blown them and they're no longer useful? Well, no, not exactly. This one has an ovenized crystal oscillator in it. So there's still some very useful parts in here. I've actually opened this up and I was looking to see if I could have some manual control. Why? So here's an interesting differential between this device and this device. Here, you have to have the GPS signal in order for this to do a lock and provide an accurate 10 megahertz signal out. Without that, as soon as you remove the GPS signal, within a short space of time, this starts to drift. Whereas this device from Leo Bodnar has some learning in it. It keeps a history of the signal that it's received, and it's gonna have a DAC which is going to control the oscillator, and it'll learn what the adjustments have been historically. So it'll keep those, just like my bigger GPS Disciplined Oscillator, it'll keep those, and so it'll be able to hold a fairly good signal coming out for a good long while, until obviously either temperature or aging starts to make a drift. Obviously then it's going to go out, but this does really well even when you have signal loss, and that's why I actually really highly recommend one of these. So if you, and again, until you've actually been in that situation where you're required to do accurate measurements, let's say where you're injecting a signal and you're having to measure a signal, and if you've played around with a frequency counter doing very precise measurements, you'll realize that the standard crystal oscillator that comes with it just does not maintain a good, accurate, stable signal. You need perhaps a temperature compensated or an ovenized crystal oscillator inside your function generator or your frequency counter, or blow that out the window, because that can still be a pain. Just inject a good signal from one of these. Now this one, you've only got one signal coming out. I have split the output signal and got away with it. So splitting the output signal, your issue there is going to be attenuation of the signal. If you split it too much, you might not have enough, but you do get splitters, or Leo Bodnar sell one of these with two outputs. So handy having this to have a reference signal for multiple devices on your bench. I wouldn't have been able to do my clock project without it. So how am I going to use this one then? Well, because I can program any frequency within this range, and I've tested this, once you've got that frequency programmed in, it's very stable. So I may end up actually using this device once I've established the exact frequency I need to run my clock, which is on the side here. I can merely program that frequency into this, power it with simple 5 volts, and this can be my time base for the clock, because I think this is going to keep very accurate time. That's going to be one of the things we see going into this, whether this works or whether I've got a few, a few other oscillators, which we'll see. Because potentially for only tens of dollars, okay, this costs $100, but those ovenized crystal oscillators, for tens of dollars and this kit, you could create a clock which is sub 10 second, sub 5 second accuracy per year. And let me tell you, if you try and buy a wristwatch with that kind of accuracy, you pay thousands of dollars. And I challenge anyone, I will in fact If someone can find, I will shout their name to the roof. I may even give them a giveaway, something for my bench. If you can find a standard tabletop or bedside clock, which is standalone, but is highly accurate, I will be really chuffed. You can either email me, or better email me than post a comment and email me, because I don't look at comments after a week after posting. So if you can do that, but that's why I'm doing this, because there just aren't any accurate standalone clocks as far as I can see. And I think we can get one together for a very low price point. Right then, so I hope that might have provided some education to anyone who might potentially be in the same situation, thinking of trying to just use a simple pigtail splitter to share a GPS signal into two GPS devices. Don't do it. Potentially you're going to blow the devices. I also think, I know sometimes some of the silly things that I get into which grab my interest are fairly niche. How many people are that interested in desktop clock which is really accurate standalone? I'm not sure there are that many people that are interested. When you can go and buy a very cheap GPS clock these days for something like $10 or $20. But I say, my challenge was to do it standalone. And through that process, I say there's been a lot of education in terms of using the tools and using tools correctly and what tools to use. I've got this very big, very old WaveCrest digital time system. It's basically a frequency counter, but it can go down to, it's got resolution down into femtoseconds. I was hoping to use this, but that proved challenging. I eventually had to try an optical coupling because of the loading and impedance. And just loading and impedance on something like this is where all the interesting little quirks come out in terms of how to get around that, and how your measurement equipment can totally mess up what you're trying to achieve on the bench. But anyway, I hope you've gained some value, and I'll come back fairly soon, I say, with an update on this clock project, the college bench power supply, and then we'll get into the full review of that very cheap bench multimeter. Thanks for watching, and cheers.